Hello and welcome to a special TV44 presentation. If you attended the 2014 Heartbeat Banquet for Life, then you had an opportunity to hear an incredible speaker. Well, good news, if you didn't attend that banquet or you want to hear her again, now is your chance. Here is Dr. Alveda King with a special presentation about life.
I want to very briefly, I'm going to go through the 10 rules that I learned from the family of Martin Luther King Jr. I'm a member of it, and that he learned. One of those rules, rules number 5, is defend life. And that's exactly what a pregnancy care center does. You know, I travel across the globe and I see so many people who try to have a contest of who's really pro-life or who's more pro-life. And some will say, well, I'm more pro-life because I pray with 40 days for life. And you know, that's very pro-life. We should all do that. I'm more pro-life because I work on legislation that has to be passed. I'm more pro-life because I pray in front of the abortion mill, and it goes on and on as to who's more pro-life. But there's no battle because there's room enough for everybody. And so we don't have to contend with each other. We just have to continue to serve. And the pregnancy care centers are very dear to my heart. And I'll go through those rules really quickly and tell you in the defend life why pregnancy care centers are so important to me personally. And I'm sure that each of you could give a personal testimony in that way. The first rule, of course, is make home a priority. And I told you about that. The second one is serve your family. Get a good education. I still support school choice, but I support good public schools, private schools, and homeschool. All education should be good. All education should be good. So get a good education. Guard your heart. That's matters of love and marriage. And I was raised this way. Now, unfortunately, I actually am divorced, and there's a long testimony about that through the abortions and et cetera. I won't give the fullness of that. But because of the fracturing of my soul and my heart by certain decisions, I was unable to bond in matrimony or with my living children. So it has been very difficult for me, but I support marriage between a man and a woman. I heard about a 62-year-old marriage today. It's one of God's most beautiful gifts to us. After salvation, it perhaps is the most beautiful, and then the children. So a baby should be born. That baby should grow up in a loving environment with the fear and admonition of the Lord. Should meet a potential spouse who loves the Lord as well. And then the two marry. And then they become intimate in the acts of marriage and have a baby. And then the baby again is conceived. And it's like Lion King would say, the circle of life, you know? And so guard your heart. And in my children's book, we say, if you guard your heart, you'll never have a broken heart. So that's how we teach that. I made some mistakes. I'm going to get to those in a few moments, but guard your heart. The next one is defend life. I'm going to come back to that. And then the next one is care for the needy. You know, the abortion ministry is part of that. That parent, that father, or that mother may not be strong enough to feel that he or she is ready to be there fully. But they made the decision for life, and so that need is met. A pregnancy care center cares for the needy from conception through the birth of the baby, sometimes at least for 2 years, if not many, many, many more. And I'm so glad to hear that you're now serving the fathers as well. I'm glad to hear that the father says, I'm now a father, and I don't know how to be one. Can you teach me how? And so, men, if you're here, you might want to be a mentor. You might want to help. Kevin Burke over at Silent No More Awareness and Rachel's Vineyard has fatherhood materials and books. If you go to silentnomoreawareness.org, you can click on the picture of the man there, and it shows things that you can do to help that family. And so that's very important. So care for the needy. And then there's fight for justice, work for peace, build the beloved community, and find your joy. I was over in Ferguson recently, and I don't know if any of you all, you may have seen that particular blog. I wrote a blog about it, and I said, no matter what the reason why, incorrect grammar, no matter what the reason why, the results still make me cry. And the journalist who had been beheaded, his father was just crying and weeping. I put his picture in the collage. I put Michael Brown in Ferguson, his parents' picture. I put girls who had lost their lives to abortion, Tanya Reeves. I put the babies there. And so when all of these things occur, they need that love, they need that compassion, they need that helping hand to turn the thing around. And that's what pregnancy care centers. When you make the community better, the world gets better. And to offer, praise the Lord, and to offer Jesus Christ, as this center does. In one of the letters that was read, the young lady said she was reading the books, but she had not thought a lot about religion. She came maybe for diapers and found Jesus. Isn't that amazing? All right, so these are things that are offered and done and can be given. Okay, fight for justice, work for peace, build the beloved community. And that means without judgment. Give corrections, give direction with compassion, because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Is there anyone in here who never made a mistake and never sinned? Can you come up here, really, if you don't mind? We all want to meet you, don't we? Oh, my God. And I tell people often, I'm like the woman at the well and the woman caught in the act. But, you know, I was meditating on that scripture recently, and Jesus said to the fishermen who became his disciples, come with me, and I will make you fishers of men. And back then, they caught the fish in a net. So the woman was caught by the net of the love of Jesus Christ in the act. But then you think about that, and I would always say, well, if she was caught in the act, who was acting with her? So Christ, of course, had to minister to the crowd of men who were standing around her. He who is without sin cast the first stone. So since none of us has lived a completely blameless, sinless, and perfect life, some much better than others, thank God, then we can afford to point the way. I say to the young people, can you raise your hand if you're 30 years or younger? Anybody here 30 or younger? Okay, we've got to. Give God the glory. Usually to get young people is a good tribute to God. Give God the glory again. Please, help me. Now, if I was back with Granddaddy, Uncle Emil, and Daddy, I say, let the church say amen. But just help me, Holy Ghost. Come on, one more time. If you are 30 years old or younger, there are many things that you are dealing with and understanding that we've never had to deal with. Certainly, the internet, we are beginning to learn. My daughter gave me my first iPhone when she got her first job. And she says, if you don't learn how to tweet, you'll never talk to me again. I had to tweet, text, and learn how to do that. So all of that is part of the world that comes into the door of that pregnancy care center. Many of the people are 30 years old and younger. Some may even be in their teens. Sometimes you may even get someone who's a little older who said, I wasn't expecting this, I'm not ready for this. So without judgment in that beloved community, young people, even people may be of different religions. And so this is what I would say to the young people when I was a college professor, when they told me, you can't say Jesus, this is a state college. I said, you can't pay me enough not to say it. Truthfully. So this particular day, I had a whole classroom full. We were in the computer lab. We were learning how to use the computer, realizing that that flip phone that Captain Kirk used to have, and he'd flip it, bing me aboard, Scotty, we realized it was real. We were teaching technology. And so I said, you know, young people, it's very true. It really doesn't matter what religion you are. You could even be an atheist. It just doesn't matter. Everybody is going to meet God, whether you believe that or not. Everybody is going to meet God. There's no argument. I said, but Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. So I said, when you get to court at the end, do you want the judge to be your father? And they would think about it. So that particular day, I'm in the classroom and I said, is there anyone here who would like to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior? Do you know, except one person, the whole class raised their hand, we prayed the sinner's prayer in this college classroom. God is not dead. God is not dead. And that one person went to the dean with a complaint. I was called back in, you can't do that. And I said, you can't pay me enough not to do it. And I meet many of those students, have met them across the years. I was there 19 years, and many of them are leading godly lives. Now, I briefly, because I want to end with this scripture, 1 Corinthians 13, I've got a real message from that, but I want to tell you quickly my testimony. And that is there in the Defend Life chapter. Father Frank Pavone, National Director of Priests for Life, wrote the afterword for me, J.C. Congressman J.C. Watts wrote the foreword. And in that particular chapter, I talk about how I was conceived in 1950. Young people, now this is for you as well. Even if you're 40 or younger, and if you're older, you know better, okay? All right. Now, or we should know better. I don't know. Maybe we don't. But mother and daddy courted since she was in the 10th grade. Daddy met her. She and her mother had come from Dothan, Alabama. Coretta Scott King had been born in Alabama as well, Marion, Alabama. The two brothers married Alabama girls. But in the 10th grade, Daddy met my mother. She was a beautiful young lady. Her part Cherokee from her father, part African-American from her mother. My daddy, Reverend A.D. King, Daddy King's grandfather, was Nathan Brannan King from Cork, Ireland. So we are part Irish. And his mother's father was born to slave parents. And his father, his grandfather, Willis Williams, was a slave preacher. And the slave masters even came over to the slave church to hear him preach. Can you imagine that? Because he preached the gospel so well. And so here you have this little young couple, part Irish, part African, part Native American. And daddy said, that's my wife. Sometimes men that early know when they meet that particular lady. So her mother, they were going to Ebenezer Baptist Church with Daddy King, and she says, you can court. Courting young people means you can go out and chase balloons, butterflies, go get ice cream cones, go skating, a lot of stuff you can do. And then you go home, and the other person goes home. You don't go home or anywhere by yourself together. So they were supervised, and they courted. Now, Mama Bessie made a big mistake when Mother was accepted in college and the engagement between the two was formal. And she says, Nene, now you can go out on a date. Only married people should date. Because dating means you go home together and you close the door, okay? And so Mama was allowed to go on the date. Another mistake Mama Bessie made, make sure AD wears a rain hat. We telling our age with our chuckles, but that's okay. A rain hat, young folks. Tell me again if you're under 40, under 30, raise your hand. Okay. A rain hat in those days would be called a condom today. Mother had been raised very innocently, never heard of a rain hat. Back in those days, gentlemen, the boys didn't need to use them too much either because the daddies had shotguns, you know? So they didn't get to use it, but every boy at coming of age tried to buy one and keep it in his wallet. So needless to say, they went on a date. Remember what I said a date is, okay? And guess who showed up on the date? Y'all figured that out yet? Okay, all right. So they were engaged, and they were going to be married, but Mother wanted to finish college before she married because she was accepted in Spelman College, and at Spelman All-Girls College, whether you were married or single, you could not be pregnant and go to college in those days. Of course, now things have changed. So there was an organization in town called the Birth Control League, and they were passing out flyers. Later, they would change their name to Planned Parenthood, and they were passing out flyers. A woman has a right to choose what she does with her body, and you should take charge of your destiny. You don't have to have children ever. Negro Project, let us help you never. or come and see us. There are procedures for mysterious female ailments because abortion was illegal. So mother realized that she had a mysterious female ailment. So she tried to get her mother to take her to the birth control league. Her mother said, no, let's go talk to our pastor, Daddy King, Dr. Martin Luther King Sr. Daddy King said to my mama, Nina, sit down, let me tell you something. They're lying to you. That's not a lump of flesh. That's my great-granddaughter. I saw her in a dream 3 years ago. She has bright skin and bright red hair, and she's going to bless a lot of people. And so that became all of that except the dream. And that's why when you hear me say I have a dream, it's in my genes, people say, there she goes, quoting Martin Luther King. No, granddaddy, Daddy King, saw me before I was born 3 years before. And so praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. So little belongs to me. Now, if you're Caucasian, you probably have family secrets. I always say, is there anybody whose family never had a secret? Come right on up. Say hello to everybody. If you're African American, you have family business. In other words, our secrets stay in this house. Anybody ever heard? Well, don't raise your hand. Or our business stays in this house. So I got accustomed to, over the years, telling all the secret business, okay? And it's not easy, but I do it. So here we are with this family secret about how I ended up being born, but I was granddaddy's favorite for many years. And as the grandchildren came, he loved all of us. In 1966, Martin Luther King Jr., my uncle, was offered the Margaret Sanger Award. Birth Control League then had become Planned Parenthood. He did not accept that award. He did not write that speech. He really didn't. Let me tell you what happened. Just like Mrs. Barbara Bush and Mrs. Laura Bush, who are pro-choice. Read that book. So read Miss Laura Bush's book. She kept that a secret till her husband left office. And Mrs. Coretta Scott King, they were pro-choice, but their husband's pro-life. And so he didn't write the speech. He didn't attend the ceremony. His wife went and read it. The secretary wrote the thank you letter. And we know this for certain. And then in 1968, you know, Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. And, you know, he would say, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Don't be like the Romans who committed infanticide. That's in his letter from a Birmingham jail. And so all of his writings indicated that he regarded the sanctity of life. He even wrote and said that. In 1968, he was assassinated. 1969, my daddy, A.D., his brother, very much like the Kennedy brothers, they looked alike, preached alike, their homes had been bombed together, they had been arrested and attacked together. They married ladies who looked just like sisters. And so daddy walked me down the aisle as a virgin, and you heard me the little joke about the shotgun a little while ago. Young people, when I was young, I really thought I was ugly, I'm not kidding. Because all the boys were chasing, all the girls trying to get a kiss. Nobody ever wanted to chase me or try to kiss me. So I said, what's wrong with me? But unbeknownst to me, daddy was following around secretly. I'm nonviolent, but I have a nonviolent baseball bat. So the boys were scared to bother me, and I'm glad he did that. So he walked his daughter down the aisle as a virgin. I got married. Daddy was killed a week later. And you can read about that in the book, too. I talk about it just a little bit. And so here I am married, conceived probably during the honeymoon or soon after. Had that firstborn baby. Granddaddy was grieving, but he was glad to get another generation, his first great-grandson. And so there was some joy. Uncle Emil would say, that's why the last chapter in that book, last rule, find your joy. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And so granddaddy, we were getting our joy back and everything, and then daddy was taken from us. And so here Martin and A.D., brothers in the struggle, who live together in heaven now, and we know that, they were gone from us. But here we are with new life in the family. Unbeknownst to us, the OBGYN, who was a trustee on the board of deacons at Ebenezer Baptist Church, he's deceased now. I had to write a letter of forgiveness for him at Rachel's Vineyard. But he was delivering babies at the hospital. But he was doing the procedure for mysterious female ailments in his office. And often many ladies came away without their children in his office. Now, he delivered my firstborn with forceps, by the way, and that young man is 44 years old. You can still see the forceps marks on his face. But when I went a few months later to ask for another pregnancy test, his response was, if your doctors or nurses, you can understand this, you don't need another baby, let's see. So he proceeded to do an examination in his office, and there was my second child. Then he says, don't talk to your family. Don't talk to the people at church. There's a nice new organization in town. Go over and talk to Planned Parenthood. And so I got the chemical artificial birth control procedures, the shots, the pills, and things like that. I also contracted a blood clotting disease called phlebitis from the chemicals. You always wonder why ladies are having more heart attacks and strokes. It's the chemical and surgical manipulation of the experiments. And then in 1973, on my birthday, by now I'm having a little trouble in my marriage, sad, depressed, all that. Separated, but tried to get back together. Roe versus Wade passed on January 22nd, 1973, on my birthday. So, during the reconciliation attempt in the marriage, I got pregnant again, and I went to Planned Parenthood for some advice. Well, you don't need another baby right now. And we have procedures now. They're legal. We can help you. And so I agreed. I was coerced into the first abortion, agreed to have the second. I was told that it was just a blob of tissue. It wouldn't hurt as much as getting a tooth pulled. Did hurt more. And it took a long time to heal, but I am healed today. Now, things get better. And men, I know you're going to like this part of this testimony. In the mid-1970s, I was unfortunately divorced. And divorce is never good, but God forgives many things. And I know I'm forgiven and healed today of many things. I really am. I know that. And so are you. So are you. In the mid-70s, our young people was dating. And I've given you an explanation of what that meant. And I conceived a child. So I was going to go over to my good friends, Planned Parenthood, because I was in great denial then and had bought all of the stories about women's lib and all this stuff. And my granddaddy, I was on the way, I was living with him at the time. I said, granddad, I'm going to run down here to Planned Parenthood. They're a good friend to women in the community. And I'm actually going to have an abortion, but I'll be back later. He says, wait a minute. He says, that's not a lump of flesh. That's my great-grandchild. The baby's daddy agreed. So that was two men that said no. And because those African-American men said that, I don't know what it was, but I had enough regard for my granddaddy, I guess. And then I saw the ultrasound. That's why that's so important that you're offering that. And I said, oh my God, he's younger than the ones who are gone. So I secretly, I'm looking at your book, I was secretly depressed, but I overcompensated. I began to achieve. I was elected as a state legislator and acting. I was doing all this. That baby was allowed to be born, and I later had some surgery and corrective procedures in my life that made my body healthy enough to bear six living children. Isn't that amazing? Six living children. Now, I'm going to connect this right back here to Heartbeat of Lima's in a moment. But for the next few years, I'm in denial, but I'm living. Granddaddy married me to the baby's father. And we ended up having five children together and my firstborn in there. Philip, Jessica, aborted, and Raphael miscarried due to harm to my body with those procedures and things. But I was married. In 1983, I became born again. I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. And he forgave me. I knew it. I knew I was going to see my children again. And so a holy boldness came on me. And that's when I went to work at the college. And I was a professor of law because I'm a certified paralegal, former state legislator in Georgia. So I knew the law, and that was one of the assignments I had for teaching at the college. And I gave my students an assignment every year that I taught business law. Morals and ethics today, has America gone too far? A woman has a right to choose what she does with her body, but the baby is not her body. Where's the lawyer for the baby? man, I got some good responses. And people, kids would knock on my door secretly and quietly. I'd counsel and pray with them. And many babies were born, many couples got married. So many things happened during those years. And I met Father Frank Pavone at the end of the 1990s and moved on as Director of African American Outreach. That's how I'm here with you today. So God saved my physical life in 1950, and I was born on January 22nd, 1951. When I was 5 years old, I received Jesus, the awareness that Jesus is a Savior. In 1983, I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior, and I got the courage to begin to speak truth to power. And that's what we're doing now. That's what we're doing now. And that's what you're doing now. Daddy King, in his own way, with his wife, had a pregnancy care center. It came out of the church and their home. They advised many young ladies and young men. Granddaddy would marry folks. No, you're going to have this baby. You're going to be married. And he did that all of his life. And back then, they called it a maternity home. Are we aware that it used to be a maternity home, a care for unwed mothers? And I don't see anything wrong with calling it that today, too. Pregnancy care does help the unwed mother. It helps the father as well. This is a noble work, a powerful work, and you're to be commended for it. I want to just share, especially to that person who prays this to God frequently. And if you don't know this scripture, it's in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I'm just going to read it quickly. And we have a little civil rights exercise that we'll end with. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not love, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I'm nothing. In the King James, it says charity. In some of the versions, it says love. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long and is kind. Love envies not. Love vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, does not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinks no evil. And it's very important. I know they don't think any evil when these young people come through these doors. We're here to help you. You're going to have to do your part. We'll help you learn how to do that. Rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. We're working on perfecting these lives here. Hallelujah. When I was a child, I spoke as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abides faith, hope, and love. These three, but the greatest of these is love. Now, can you join hands with your neighbor? And somebody just said, I don't even like the person next to me. That's okay. Fake it. The Bible says, put on love. Just pretend, okay? So hold hands together now really quickly. There's a very familiar song. And in the civil rights movement, when we marched, we sang hymns and spiritual songs. I marched and went to jail too. This is a spiritual movement now for life, the sanctity of life, for the babies, for the sick, for the elderly, and for the fathers and the mothers and for the community. So we're gonna pretend that we are on a civil rights march. So while you're sitting there, start marching. Don't get up, just march. Move your feet like you're marching. It's okay, everybody say, is she kidding? No. Okay. Now we're gonna sing a familiar song. I'm gonna teach you two quick verses. Can somebody come up here and hold hands with me too? So I can march. Anybody, come on. Jennifer, anybody, come on. Jennifer's okay. Both of you, come. Come, everybody, come. If you were up, come on. We gotta have the march here, okay? Now, here we are. We're going to show you how to do it. We'll really be marching, okay? We're going to hold hands now. When we start, we're going to sing, okay? And you sing along too, and I'm going to teach you two quick verses, okay? This little light of mine, sing. I'm going to let it shine, oh, this little light of mine. Keep marching. I'm going to let it shine, this little light of mine. I'm going to let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Now keep marching.
Thanks for watching our special presentation. Dr. Alveda King, 10 Reasons to Live. Don't forget to live for life. We want to remind you that we can bring you presentations like this one thanks to your partnership. As a viewer-supported TV station, we are so thankful for your financial support and want to remind you, as we are currently in our annual pledge drive, now is your opportunity to partner with us for 2015. If you have more information, or for more information on that, give us a call at 419-339-4444 or visit our website, WTLW.com.